A recent Wall Street Journal poll found most Republican voters think fighting woke ideology is more important than even protecting Social Security and Medicare from cuts. 55% feel this way. This may clash with a NORC poll from March. It found on issues including schools and businesses promoting racial diversity and acceptance of transgender people that majorities think the country is on the right track or not doing enough. Either way, whatever's considered woke will most certainly come up among Republican presidential candidates. If and when Florida Governor Ron DeSantis decides to run, it may even be a campaign feature.
We will never surrender to the woke mob. Florida is where woke goes to die.
Florida and other states have passed new rules recently that may be considered anti-woke. Some have passed rules against gender transition surgeries for minors, and some have rules banning transgender athletes from competing in girls and women's sports. Last week, U.S. House Republicans passed a bill that would amend Title IX by banning transgender athletes from competing in women and girls' sports at schools that receive federal funding.
Make no mistake, this is not a culture war. They are trying to diminish and erase who we are as women, and I will not stand for it. I'm proud to vote for this bill.
Marionette Miller Meeks is a Republican congresswoman from Iowa. Concerns around transgender athletes competing with women got increased attention when University of Pennsylvania swimmer Leah Thomas, a trans swimmer, won the NCAA championship in the 500-meter race last March. She then tied for fifth place with another swimmer in the 200-meter. Last week, the Biden administration said they want a rule that says bans on transgender folks from girls and women's sports violates Title IX. Thomas spoke out on her Instagram.
This rule is a good start. However, it is not enough. During this time of intense anti-trans backlash, the trans community needs explicit protections from discrimination in order to live our lives freely and equally.
But the female swimmer Thomas had to share that fifth place trophy with has been speaking out herself.
There's a lots of different moving pieces, whether that be at the state level, the federal level, within specific sporting bodies.
Riley Gaines is a 12-time NCAA All-American swimmer and now spokesperson for the Independent Women's Forum.
So there's lots of different moving parts when I'm fighting to protect women's sports. And so it feels as if I'm everywhere. But that's exactly where I want to be, is anywhere and everywhere where I can be contributing to ensuring that no woman or young girl has to unfairly compete against a male-bodied athlete or share a locker room with someone of the opposite sex. And so what I've been doing a lot of these past couple months is testifying at the state legislature, like you saw in North Carolina, doing everything I can to help encourage the left-leaning representatives or delegates to understand how this is harmful to women and how this isn't something that's anti-trans or deeply rooted in hate. And I think this is something that the Republicans could do a better job of, the language they use to talk about these things. I have a lot of opinions there. And so I'm trying to do my best on communicating my message in a way that highlights how we as women are being affected and how this is unfair.
You noted the House bill at the congressional level. It did pass in the House, as you noted, along party lines, but it likely will not go further than that. The Senate likely won't take it up, and the White House has said the president will veto it. I wonder if that leaves you at a state level for now. Like, is that the focus?
I don't want to say anything until it doesn't go through, but I am not overly confident that it will, obviously, as most people know. But there's a lot going on with Title IX, which is, of course, a federal civil rights law. The Biden administration, they have rewritten what Title IX will be. And I think this will be implemented in either May or June. And this would be detrimental to women, not only women in sports, but this would mean that men could join sororities, men could live in dorm rooms with women, men could have full access to any restroom or changing space on campus for women. So there's a lot of different pieces of this new Title IX that I feel as if the general public isn't really realizing. And so I've made it my goal, while yes, I am focusing majorly on the state level in terms of passing legislature that will combat this issue, it's important to highlight to the general public exactly what the Biden administration is doing and the exact message they're sending to girls and women, because that message is that they don't matter, their feelings doesn't matter, their safety, their privacy, their dignity, their equal opportunities don't matter.
Riley, when it did pass the House, the minority leader, Democrat Hakeem Jeffries, made a couple of points that we've heard from others, including that this kind of legislation, it bullies trans women and girls. I imagine that's not the first time you've heard that it's bullying to ban trans women and girls from competitions, from sports. What do you say back to that? When have you been accused of being a bully?
Absolutely. I have been accused of every name in the book. People will call you transphobic. They'll call you bigot. They'll call you hateful. They'll call you a racist for some reason, even though this has nothing to do with race. They will throw terms at you, hoping that you'll falter from your beliefs if you're called these names. They want you to think you're guilty of committing hate speech. But hate speech is not speech that you hate. That is not what hate speech is defined as. But that's their tactic. That's what they want to achieve. They want you to be perceived as this hateful person who has no compassion in their heart. But speaking for myself, I know that's not true. I have compassion in my heart for every single person, regardless of age, sex, gender identity, your race, regardless of who you are. I believe everyone should be entitled to sports. These bills that are being passed at both the state and federal level, the left loves to say that this is an anti-trans bill that bans trans youth from competing or trans athletes from competing, which is just a lie. This is not a bill that bans anyone. Everyone is entitled fair and safe competition in these bills. And so it's hard for me to understand the problem. Other common misconceptions is they will say that this bill would require forced inspections of student athletes, which is an egregious violation of a student's personal dignity. That, again, that is not what these bills are doing. They're referring back to a birth certificate and or ensuring everyone has a routine physical before competing, which is standard, especially if you're playing at the high school, middle school, collegiate level. So there's lots of misconceptions about the bill that the left loves to push about the people who are supporting the bill that are simply not true. It does not make someone a bigot to understand that there are two sexes, to understand that you cannot change your sex, especially to diminish the advantages after you've gone through puberty, and to understand that women deserve respect and that women deserve equal opportunity.
Have you personally had any conversations with trans folks who either tell you you're wrong or maybe tell you they understand why you feel the way Absolutely. You feel? Or have you reached out on your own to any transgender? Like, what have the conversations you've had been like?
Absolutely, I have. Especially, I'm someone who likes to remain sensible, likes to be knowledgeable, likes to consider all perspectives. And so within this LGBTQ community, I've had so many conversations with members of this community. What I've noticed, a lot of people within the LGB community, in regards to one's sexual orientation, not necessarily their sexual identity, they're really frustrated with this movement because they feel as if they fought for their rights. They feel as if they were finally at a place where, in many places, it's almost acceptable to be homosexual or to be bisexual. But they feel as if this trans movement, this gender ideology movement, has hurt what they once fought for. And how they have described it to me is they don't feel as if the trans community is necessarily fighting for their rights. They feel as if they're taking others' rights away, which is an interesting perspective, and I think it's true. By allowing trans-identifying individuals into women's spaces and women's sports and women's prisons and women's shelters, we're not getting equal rights. They're taking away our rights. I've also talked to a lot of people within the trans community who understand that being a trans woman does not mean you are a biological woman. They know there's differences. They know that a trans woman can never get pregnant. They know that they will never have a menstrual cycle. They know that they have a different bone structure. There's a lot, of course, a lot of differences between a trans woman and a woman, and they acknowledge that. So I've had great conversations with people within the T community as well. But of course, you have subsets of this, or even just allies to this community who will do everything they can to silence you and convince you that you're wrong for feeling uncomfortable in a locker room next to a male. And that just makes you a bigot and all of these different things. So that community definitely goes both ways. But the amount of conversations I've had in support of my stance on this issue, and we could disagree on a lot of other things, but on this particular issue, they're very supportive and they understand.
Finally, Riley, you said you think Democrats will pay for their stance on this issue in 2024. And I wonder, do you really think it rises to that level? I mean, we've got a lot going on, right? Inflation, the economy, worries over China, and even still many are worried about the overturning of Roe, especially in certain states. And I just wonder if you really do believe this issue will rise to that level of mattering in when it comes time to vote.
I have talked to so many women who are lifelong liberals who are seeing how the Democrats are denying womanhood. We've now deemed it offensive to use the term mother. It's now birthing person. It's offensive to use the term breastfeeding. It's now chest feeder. And these women who, again, are still relatively sensible and can understand what this means in the long run for the erasure of women, they're not okay with this. And this is a hill they're willing to die on. And so I truthfully think we have this idea of feminism, what the original feminist movement was about,
right,
which was, of course, empowering and embracing and honoring and celebrating women based off of their own physical ceilings and their own uniqueness. But now the left has totally denied that. So I do think the Democrats will pay in 2024. Not one of them voted in the U.S. House of Representatives to protect women and girls in sports, which was mind-blowing because even within the Democratic Party, I saw a recent poll where nearly 60 to 70% of Democratic voters don't agree with allowing males into women's sports and spaces. And so they're clearly not representing their party even accurately.
And Riley, one more finally for you. When you said earlier that you think Republicans maybe need to shift some of their language or the way they talk about this, what would you tell them to say?
I think what the left does pretty well, typically, is they make things about emotion. They make things about humanity. They have this level of compassion and empathy, which appeals to a lot of people. I think how the Republicans can frame the conversation around this issue in particular is the left loves to say, okay, well, what about the mental health of this athlete? I think the Republicans need to come back with, okay, but why are you neglecting the mental health of women and their self-perception? Rather than just continuing to say this is about fairness, which, yes, of course, it's about fairness. But there's other pieces that could make this more compassionate, because in my experience, this is something that affected women in a harmful way, not just because of the unfair competition, but sharing a locker room with a male is traumatizing. It makes us feel as if we're not worthy enough for fair competition. Just because we're women, we don't deserve equal opportunities. And that's a hard realization when you've trained your entire life for something. And so I think the Republicans could do a better job of combating this compassion with more compassion. And it's more powerful coming from the Republicans because they're speaking for the majority, whereas the Democrats are speaking for the minority.
Riley Gaines, thank you so much for joining us.
Of course. Thank you, guys.